today we're out at the Southeast Research Center and we're looking at some different factors that affect silage density as well as kernel processing as we get ready for harvest season this fall. I'm Dr. Mike Brouk. I'm with Kansas State University, where I'm a dairy extension specialist and also do some undergrad teaching. Specifically today, we'll be taking a look at how we evaluate kernel processing, very simple field method that we can use so we can keep track of our kernel processing efficiency as we actually harvest the corn silage. Also be taking a look at some different silage densities and looking at a way in which we can measure silage density as we pack piles during the actual process. Today we want to take a little bit of time to just understand how we can do a better job of evaluating kernel processing while we're chopping corn silage this fall. So one of the easiest ways to do that is to take a cup like this. It's 32 ounces. And take just a cup of silage and then put it into a pan or something that we can sort out kernels. The kernels we're actually looking for as we sort through this corn silage is we're looking for kernels that are at least half or more in size. So we're trying to identify just how much kernel damage we've actually had with the kernel processor on the chopper. So we sort through the sample, and again, it's about 32 ounces of sample that we're looking at. Only takes just a short period of time to actually do this. And when you're done on this plate, you'll have the number of kernels that are either half or more in size yet. So what we're trying to achieve is we actually only want two of those kernels to four of those kernels per 32 ounce cup of silage. If we have more than that, that means that we have not done an adequate job of kernel processing. So you can see in this particular sample, we've got a large number of kernels that are in some cases even as much as whole, and many kernels that are just barely broken or half or greater in size yet. So this is not adequately processed. Have some other samples of corn silage as well that we've already sorted out. And in this particular case, again, we see a fairly large number of kernels that have pieces that are either a whole kernel or at least more than half of a kernel. So again, this silage is not adequately processed. And it was a drier silage. A lot of times drier silages will have more of an issue with it than wetter silages. So over here is a sample, for example, that as I sorted through it, it's been processed very well. There's actually no pieces of kernel that are half or greater in size. So someone's done an excellent job of setting up their chopper and operating it correctly on that one. Here's another sample, and you can see only two kernels that are half or larger. So again, excellent job of processing with this particular silage. So it's really important as we work it through our silage season, particularly in our corn silage, that during the day, while we're chopping, every hour, we go out and we actually evaluate at least one sample to make sure that the kernel processing is occurring the way that we really want it to, so we'll have more starch available for our dairy cows when we feed the silage after it's ensiled. We want to talk a little bit about some things that we can do if we do not have a kernel processor on our chopping machine and we're still chopping corn silage. So one of the things you can do is you can decrease the cut length. So we have samples of silage that were cut at 1/4 inch theoretical cut, 1/2 inch theoretical cut, and 3/4 inch theoretical cut. Now, as we cut the silage finer, we'll have fewer of these cobwheels in there. We'll also do more kernel damage. So you can see as you sort through this sample, we've got a couple of pieces that of the cobwheel, but really the kernels have mostly been crushed by the chopping of the machine without a kernel processor. Here's, for example, a whole kernel, but very few in this. However, as we start to increase the cut length, so when we go to the 1/2 inch chop length, you see that we have more pieces of the cob wheels. And these generally will not be consumed by livestock. The cattle will generally leave these in the bunks. The other thing that you'll start to see is you'll start to see more whole kernels. In other words, we're doing less kernel damage because we're not chopping the silage as fine. If you lengthen out to 3/4 of an inch theoretical cut length, which when we're doing kernel processing on the silage as well, that's generally our theoretical cut length for that type of silage. But if you don't have a kernel processor, you're going to see a lot of cob wheels. And the cob wheels, are, again, will be refused by the livestock. We'll have to clean those out of the bung. We'll also see an increase in the number of kernels that have not been chopped by the chopping mechanism on the chopper. So you're going to have less kernel damage. So the reason for pointing this out is that if we're in a situation where our silage chopper does not have a kernel processor, we can just simply chop the silage finer. We will cause more kernel damage, which will allow us to have more starch available to the animal, and they'll get better utilization out of it than they would if we chopped that same silage at 3/4 of an inch when we did not have the kernel processor on the machine.
I'm Sara Bauder. I work with SDSU Extension as an agronomy field specialist, and here with me today is Dr. Michael Brouk. He's with K-State Extension, and we're here to talk about a rye silage study that we put together for a forage field day. And this study was rather interesting. About a month and a half ago, we took a hybrid rye that was at soft dough stage and ensiled it. At the time, we determined it was about 44% dry matter. And we put it in these mineral tubs at different packing densities as well as chop lengths. It was straight cut with a silage chopper, and we actually used mechanical action to pack it at different densities. So we have a 1/4 inch cut, a 1/2 inch cut, and a 3/4 inch cut chop length. And we're looking at how these different chop lengths store and pack. So we took each of those chop lengths and we did 3 different packing densities. And you can see there is a light, a medium, and a heavy packing density. And the way that we put this together was using some mineral tubs and known weights of the as-fed feed when we put it in wet, knowing how deep the layer needed to be to reach our packing density, and used mechanical pressure to push down the silage or the rylage into the tubs until we reached the achieved density, then double bagged it, and it's been ensiled for over a month now in these tubs.
So one of the things that we can do to check density is we can actually take a tube like this. It's 2 inches in diameter, and we've got a sharpened area here on the end, and we can use this then to core down into a silage mass, whether it be in a tub like this or a bunker silo or even a drive over pile. So I just want to demonstrate how we can use the sampling. So we drill down through, then we take the material out of here, and we can actually weigh it. So this core is of a known length if we measure, and also a known amount of forage in there. So we can actually use this then to check the silage density. So in this tub, we've got a core that we've taken out before, and I'm going to just place this fresh core in it. So if we were actually doing the density, we would actually measure with a scale the amount of forage that we have here. But as you look at these 3 different samples, so this is the silo that had the least amount of density, a medium amount of density, and then this one would have been the one that was packed the most dense. And you can kind of see there's actually, visually, you can see there's less in this tub than this one as opposed to the heavier packed one. So we do have less material here. We have less density, which is what we would expect in this sort of a situation. As far as the actual densities that they were able to pack to here, the one over here on the far side that is the higher density silage, that'd be about what we'd get in a silage bag, somewhere between this one and the middle one. This one here would be like a silage bag that wasn't very well packed at all. So give you a relative idea of the different densities and how it would relate to what we might see in a commercial setting.
It was very telling when we packed these mechanically by hand, which was the lighter and which was the most dense. One thing about small grain silage is that most stems are hollow. So as you pack, you can pack down tight, just like you would with a pile or a bunker, but as soon as you take that pressure off, there tends to be a lot of action to fluff back up. So that did create some issues, and we were actually not able to get these silos as dense as we wanted them to, simply because we couldn't get enough mechanical action to pack them tightly. So it really does show the importance of packing density. The idea behind making these mini silos was to look at corn silage packing densities as well as chop lengths and the interactions between the two. They're very important factors in putting up and storing corn silage. And next to us here is the quarter inch, the half inch, and the 3/4 inch chop lengths. And each of these chop lengths are probably common across the state, but some are definitely better than others. And within each chop length, we have 3 packing densities. And you can see them on the labels here, basically light, medium, and a heavy packing density. You can visually see some differences in the silos within each chop length. The way we put this together was to calculate how much corn silage it would take within a certain number of inches in each tube to reach the density. So we're packing a lot more corn silage into a smaller space in each tube to make them more dense as we move from left to right. It was very telling as we did this mechanically with a post tamper, essentially. As you can imagine, you start with the light one and it's very easy to do. You get to the medium, it takes a while, and by the time you get to the heavy packing densities, it's very difficult to tamp, and it's obvious with mechanical action why it's harder to get the oxygen out at a heavy packing density.
So when we look at these different densities, for example, this silo that wasn't packed very dense, the lowest density here, this would be very similar to the density that we might find in a silage bag on a commercial dairy. As we move to the medium packing rate, this would be a density that would be fairly typical in like a drive over pile or maybe even a bunker silo that we might have packed with a tractor. And then finally, the heaviest packing rate, the most dense, would be what we're really trying to move dairy producers and beef producers to try to reduce the amount of dry matter loss that we have in silos. So this 17 pounds of dry matter per cubic foot would be what we would be wanting to try to achieve ideally when we're trying to pack silage into either a drive over pile or into a bunker silo.
These samples were about 31% dry matter off of a 75-day corn that we planted in order to have it ready for this field day. So at that percentage, we thought we would be awfully wet, but that's getting pretty close to ideal, so we can see the differences in our silos.